hotel. Yeah, they'll
good,
know.
Good
the,
evening,
the
everybody.
Bar at the Shrine.
I think we have more or less a full hall, so we'll begin. I'd like to thank everybody for coming this evening. And for those of you who may not know me, my name is Alan Dempsey. I lead the independence group here at the school, in addition to directing the architectural practice NECS here in London. I want to open by just outlining what is tonight the first lecture in a series we're having this year called Designing Fabrication. And the idea for the series was really to expose the community here at the school to distinctive new practices that are redefining the relationship between design and making of our environments at the differing scales of furniture and installations through to architecture and larger scale infrastructure. Enabled by increasing integration of computational environments, new communications platforms, and economic digital manufacturing tools, all of the participating designers in the series are actively engaging with and reconfiguring manufacturing processes to explore novel formal and performative design territories. So participants in the series this term include SHoP here this evening, and Ball Nogues next week, and I think in the next week or so we'll be announcing another group for term two, next term. In compiling a short list of the most, for me at least, the most interesting practices globally that are exploring this emerging territory between design, computation, and manufacturing, there were three questions that came to my mind that I felt any speaker should be in some way addressing through their work. The first question concerns the ways in which creative repertoires of architecture itself are being expanded, and how these creative explorations are leading to new kinds of spatial experience that are perhaps more calibrated to contemporary tendencies of use or communication in our societies. Secondly, I was interested in offices that were really questioning how performance becomes a more substantive issue than style. And here I'm interested in practices that really were trying to escape the limits of exploration of formal novelty for the sake of it, to address a more complex project of multiple integrated systems that come closer to dealing with the challenges that we actually face as architects and as a society as a whole. And finally, I think the convergence of design and digital manufacturing processes are challenging both the definition and boundaries of our profession, and we are interested in practices who are really exploring new tools to extend professional influence within the design team to give architects greater design control while also offering the possibility of rebalancing issues of risk and reward. So I think we're very fortunate to have Gregg here tonight to represent SHoP, because in a sense, it's a practice that is so remarkable for addressing all of those three questions. And to use their own words, their mission is no less than to reinvent the business model of architectural practice by challenging the process of building and seeking to prove that beauty and technological proficiency are not mutually exclusive. Founded in 1996 in New York by five partners whose educational and professional experience ranges from architecture to fine arts, structural engineering, finance, and business management, it's a kind of multidisciplinary office that whose breadth is reflected really in the kind of range of practices they're currently undertaking, from traditional architectural services through to construction management consultancy and more recently environmental consultancy. The office works across a variety of project types, from multi-story housing to academic and commercial buildings to master plans. And current work includes the Barclays Center and the Fashion Institute of Technology in New York, and the enormous Botswana Innovation Hub. Gregg himself, in addition to his practice commitments, he's had a long-standing commitment to teaching and academic research, having taught at Yale University of Virginia and Columbia University Graduate School. He serves on the board of directors for the Architectural League of New York and as a Young Leaders Fellow of the National Committee on United States-China Relations. So please welcome for me, Gregg Pasquarelli.
Thank you, Alan, very much. I'll just say, just to start, everything I say is off the record, because after 200 lectures over the past 15 years on six continents, my last lecture was the first time I got burned by a reporter hiding in the audience pretending to be a student. So from now on, I've got to just say it's off the record, but you're welcome to ask any kind of question as we go. I just don't want to see any of this in print tomorrow. So anyway, it's great to be here at the AA. You know, I think that coming out of Columbia in the early 90s and sort of having Bernard Tschumi and Peter Eisenman as mentors and teachers, we always felt we were sort of a second or third generation derivative of your education here in London. And we've always sort of looked up to the school and what it represents, and it's always an honor to be here. The last time I lectured here was, I think, 2002. When our AD came out, versioning in architecture. And last time I lectured in London was at the Bartlett in 05. So we're due to be back, and it's great to see our friends, our good friends from London. Thanks for coming out and supporting us tonight. So SHoP originally stood for Sharpless Holden Pasquarelli, which are the names of the founding partners. But even though there are three names, there are actually five founding partners, and that's because the partnership is made up of two husbands and wives and the identical twin brother of one of the husbands. So that sort of confused everybody, so we made this chart to explain it to our clients, which basically, this is the, we all five of us went to Columbia, and this is the year that we graduated, so the four of us were in the same class. Chris was a little ahead. If you're in a green box, it means you're married, and you share things like bank accounts. And if you're in the blue blob, you're identical twins, and you share things like genetic code. I think that one of the things that really, one thing I think that led us to the way that we started to look at architecture was that all five of us had previous careers before coming to design. And whether that's an advantage or a disadvantage, I have no idea. But it just allowed us to kind of think about freely adapting other methods of problem solving from other industries and try to bring them to design. And I think that in our firm, we also really, really try to get as much difference in background and education in the way that we sort of think and kind of have this think tank laboratory kind of practice. But the thing that really brought the five of us together was this is SHoP's like last 150 years in architectural history in one slide drawing. And the thing was that, you know, sort of starting in the 1970s and into the 80s, and funny, going to the postmodernism show today at the V&A was really kind of interesting how it was being presented, how history is now being presented. But this kind of division that happened in our profession was something that the five of us really were very frustrated about and didn't really understand why. And great architects, many of whom are now world famous practitioners, sort of said to us, you know, like, hey, you guys are pretty good designers. Like, so what are you going to do when you get out? Are you going to do like really cool designs and enter competitions? Or are you going to actually know how to put a building together and work at a big corporate office? And that was incredibly frustrating to us, that would even be a way that an architect would think about it. And at the same time, I think because we came from the outside, we really were very critical of the kind of cycle of theoretical consumption, if you will. This idea that, you know, a few papers would be written, a kind of an aesthetic would get attached to it, it would get a show at MoMA, three buildings would get built, and then it would be derided as passé. And this kind of idea just didn't seem to be, to us, what we wanted to practice architecture, why we wanted to practice architecture. And so we kind of came together with this idea of, you know, both and, not in the sort of Venturi way of both and, but this notion that you could teach and do research and think and care about art, and you also could equally invest in ideas about technology and production and politics and finance. And was there a space in architectural culture for a firm that could do both of those things? And in the same way that what Alan was just talking about this notion of what the aesthetic would be that would be attached to that, or would there be an aesthetic attached to it? And so this is sort of 1994, 95, 96, and we started thinking about the notion of performance-based design, we worked with a lot of our professors who were also thinking and writing about this stuff. And I think that a lot of the places that we began to see it in its most fruitful relationships were in the aerospace and the automotive industry. And of course, there's lots of ideas about performance-based design in nature. There's a long history in architecture and fabrication, and the idea that anytime there's a kind of technological or material change or move forward, there would also be this opportunity to explore form, ornament, production, connection, fabrication, and how these things would go together. And is that me? Someone's mobile. Okay. Anyway, so there was this kind of idea of really looking to the way that aerospace worked, again, the kind of history of the synthesis between engineering and design, and using that as a way to kind of move forward. So, you know, in 1994, Columbia was still not the quote-unquote computer school, yet we always knew that there was, as we started to play, as the computers were getting fast enough and cheap enough, and we were just out of school and we were doing our own research in our own offices, we were trying to look at these relationships between form and performance and think about the kinds of relationships that would come. And just because of the tech, the sort of issues about the software, it was often producing complex form. Now, whether that was the way we wanted to go or not go, we just felt it was a kind of interesting thing in the sense that there was an incredibly long history of complex form in architecture and design, but of course it always relied on labor to produce it. And so, of course, modernism, which relies a lot less on labor, this stuff became really, really expensive to produce. And so, as a kind of young office, we said, look, we're not going to get geary budgets, so we better figure out what's next technologically if we want to be able to produce the kinds of drawings that we want to do and not get them value engineered or taken away from us as a young firm. So it was very clear, and this is 1996, that the key place to go was in CNC fabrication. That if we could figure out how to really engage the computer as not only a tool to help us design, but also to manufacture and assemble very, very early on, and keep those costs at a reasonable level, we would actually have a shot to get these things built as a young practice. So that was what we did. We had our first laser cutter in our office in 97. We had our first three-dimensional printer in our office in 98. I mean, 900-person SOM had zero 3D printers. Five-person shop had one 3D printer. So we were like, we're already ahead. Let's go. Let's go after these guys. And it was a fascinating process for us because by sort of invest, and I mean, we went to the manufacturers. We were, oh, well, the computer will make this. I mean, they thought we had three heads on our shoulders. And they just thought we were crazy. But you know, now it's so mainstream in a way. It's so normal. But at the time, this was really, we were kind of saying, this is our only chance as a young practice to compete with the bigger firms. So what was most interesting about it, though, was that as we started to make drawings and think about all of these issues, this kind of simultaneity of thinking about production as almost a driver for design and design as a driver for assembly, the kinds of drawings that we started to make started to go further and further away from plan, section, and elevation. And we started to realize that that abstract language as architects really was becoming more and more obsolete. And that it started to become more about how do the pieces get made, what's the sequence of time, what are the ways that they go together, and then what are the ways that the machine make all the parts. So for SHoP, very, very early on in our practice, it never was really about the form in and of itself. It was about how it was put together and what it did, how it acted, how it performed, that mattered to us. So whether it's several of the hundreds of different shaped bricks in Brunelleschi's dome or three of the 4,000 uniquely shaped pieces of zinc that we fabricated on our building, the Porterhouse, it was really, we started to realize that it was about grabbing back territories that architecture had given up over the previous decades. And that the more we sort of engaged in the technology, the more we engaged in the way things got made, we actually got more freedom to design. And so it became this ability to sort of capture the master builder idea of architecture that gave us the design freedom to think about theoretical positions. So it was this sort of equal and opposite reaction, a kind of very clear Newtonian relationship. So we started doing all this, and then we ran up against the AIA, which I'm sure all of you know what that is. And this is the only drawing in the AIA documents. And we will pretend that this is the single worst architectural drawing in the history of man. This is not a drawing by architects. This is a drawing that's made by lawyers who want to ensure that they have business for the rest of their lives. This is a drawing that takes the three key players in the production of space and puts them in opposite positions from each other. And so we realized very early that using CNC technology and manufacturing and starting to blur the edges of where architects and designers could practice and the way they could interact with their clients and with the builders was a big threat to that money-making machine for the legal profession, certainly in the United States. We just started to ask ourselves, you know, what are the ways that you as a young firm could begin to expand practice? And what are the implications of that? And what does it mean for both design and the way in which one performs in the making of space? So over the years, SHoP has actually formed a series of different companies, some successful and not so successful. So we've done our own real estate development. We now have SHoP Construction, which is a sort of CM advisory company that actually helps other architects use all the things that we've learned in 15 years of research and are working with some of the best architects in the world right now, helping them do their buildings. There's our design practice. There's a sustainability technology practice. We've started an applications company. Our first product is going to probably roll out in about 3 or 4 months. And then even a practice where we worked with Bure Happold and HRNA to help building owners begin to sort of turn their buildings green, if you will. Now, some of these have been successful, some of them have not been successful, but it never really mattered to us. This wasn't about making money, although if you make some money, that's not necessarily a bad thing. But what it really was about was using the skills that architects have to engage on multiple levels in order to stake territory, reclaim territory that we've lost, in order to make architecture and design a more relevant part of the making of cities and the making of space. So because this is a fabrication lecture, I added some kind of older projects just to show how, as a young office, we kind of tried to take these ideas and very simply move them into now what are much, much larger kinds of projects. So I'll go all the way back. I haven't presented this in a long time, but it's kind of fun. To our project we did at PS1, which is part of the Museum of Modern Art. Some of you may know they have a competition every year for a young architect to build a kind of installation in the courtyard for the summer. So this was 2000. And the year before we did it, a guy named Philip Johnson had done the pavilion in the courtyard. And we thought that was kind of really strange. But Terry Riley and Alana Heiss from MoMA and PS1 said, look, we want to make this about young architects. And now for a decade since, it's really been a kind of key prize for young architects in the States to win. So the basic premise is just this idea of an urban beach. And we said, if we thought about that performatively, what would that mean? So we said, if you had a kind of shading device, a place to change, a place to sit, a place to dance, and a place to get wet, and you took a series of surfaces and mutated those surfaces along their length to enable every one of those programs or performances, in fact, you would have a beach, whether you had sand or water or not. The other main performative element is this is sort of where you enter the courtyard and you enter the museum, was the notion of the promenade of the beach, this action where you walk up and down the beach and you look for your friends, or you hang out on the beach and you watch everyone go by. The architecture was placed in such a way that the sort of unsuspecting museum goers became the promenaders. So this was the very first drawing. We had $50,000 to build it, 3 weeks to design it, and 3 weeks to build it. And so we just said, well, let's just take a single stick element, shift that stick, take these kind of control splines between the joints, and manipulate them into a way so that the surface would unfold, that every single one of those performances could occur on the surface itself. This is the kind of BIM version 0.0.1, a full model of the kind of, the red was the sort of A, the blue is the B, and the purple is the overlap. So it was just a series of sticks that went together AB, AB, like that. The connection point being the spline. The spline dimensions were all relative to sizes of the body and the performances that needed to be unfolded. This is the full set of construction documents. That was a full-scale templated system. It's not out of focus. Here's one drawing blown up. These drawings were 15 feet high by 30 feet long. And you followed a color sequence. You aligned your stick. When they crossed, you hit it with a stainless steel screw, and you trimmed off the two edges, and you moved to the next piece. And so a series of Columbia students, fully paid, I might add. We are the only firm in PS1's history to actually pay the people who worked on it. So $30,000 of our $50,000 budget went to the staff. And you can see the pieces going together and being trimmed. And it went together in 2 weeks and 4 days. So with the three extra days that we had, we asked MoMA if we could have the courtyard for one night. And we got to throw one heck of a party, filling this with a lot of beer and booze and ice. So anyway, there was a sort of forest of steel trees that blew mist every 15 minutes and filled the courtyard with the mist of the ocean. Water was pumped on the roof and came down a waterfall. There were places to go inside and jump in and get wet. There was this kind of smooth transition between seating and walls and enclosures. Hanging out, there were these interior chambers that you could climb in. There were other places where you could change. You could sort of see the different zones. And then sort of what it looked like on a particular day and when the party would go on. Now, the interesting thing about that project was, had we not thought about, the whole design came out of the assembly process. And had we not thought about it that way, there's no way we get this thing built. And the most and for a very reasonable budget. And the most interesting thing was that Philip Johnson had done it the year before, and they got 2,000 people every weekend to come out. When this building or installation was finished, we got over 75 articles, televisions, spots, a lot of different things. Thank you. And it's good actually with it off, if you don't mind. Oh no, you need it for the TV. But the fascinating thing was, we averaged, at the end of the summer, we asked MoMA, we said, so how many people came? And they said, well, you averaged more than 8,000 people a weekend. And so it was the last weekend, I was sitting with Kim, we were talking about it, and we said, 6,000 additional people per weekend, times the 10 weekends in the summer, times $10 admission, plus an average of two or three beers and a hot dog or a hamburger. That's fascinating. We just generated more than $1 million for the museum, and our fee was $15,000. And I said, what's wrong with architecture, and how are we going to fix it? Because if we, in almost any other profession, if you ever were able to do something like that, you would certainly be paid a much different sum than $15,000. But why do we let ourselves do that as a profession? So, the next time that we really, the sort of next big jump in this idea of fabrication of materials came from, again, an early project we did. It was an international competition we won to build a park with a series of follies in it in Greenport, New York. And the park had, the main center part was an antique carousel house that sat in the park, an amphitheater. We designed a marina. There was a kind of water park that changes to a skating rink, a ferry terminal, a harbor walk, shade pavilions. But right at the end, the last piece we did, and this project was government funded, we ended up writing grants for the town, we became a licensed soil remediators because there were no soil remediators available 100 miles from New York City for a year. We just figured out how to do it and got the soil remediated. And after 8 years of working on this project, we came to the last piece, which was a folly that the mayor wanted. He requested a camera obscura. So we said, okay, we'll do it, but let's get the whole park built first. So, again, this was pretty much our first project out of school. And you could see the ferry terminals. You could see the water park. We did reuse the Mr. Heads from PS1 and sold them to the town of Greenport and made up a little bit of our money there. Here you could see the Mist Heads. The harbor walk with the lights, the carousel house. It turns to a skating rink in the summertime. The carousel house, the entire building has operable walls that are set on worm drive, so it can respond automatically to the microclimate, whether there are breezes coming off the water, or in the winter it's closed down, summer it's opened up. But we got to the end, and we sort of had the trust of the client, and we said, can we really use the last building as a kind of R&D project? Could we use the camera obscura? Because we'd like to see if we can make a pure performance envelope design and see if we can have the entire building manufactured by the computer. So they said, okay. So this was the basic program, what all the requirements were. They were placed in several different positions, and we ran some scripts that we wrote to make a kind of minimum surface that would allow those programs to occur. And this is the model, and this we'd call BIM version 0.1, because we actually just manually modeled all 2,800 parts that went into the camera. Again, not a great idea to do at home, but we tried it anyway. And it was a fascinating project because these are the actual construction documents. So every different material was cataloged and placed in its position three-dimensionally. And the drawings became sort of two kinds of drawings. It was either a set of instructions for how the machine would make the parts, or a set of instructions that would just show how the pieces went together. And these are the drawings. There's nothing taken off of these for presentation. And the fascinating thing is when we finished the set of drawings, there were 35 drawings, something like that. We didn't even realize it, but we looked at it at the end and there were no dimensions on the whole set because dimensions were no longer needed. Every single part arrived to the site pre-cut, pre-numbered, pre-slotted, pre-drilled, ready to go together like the most kick-ass piece of IKEA furniture you've ever seen in your life. And the drawings said stuff like this, like fold, weld, bolt, screw. And as we'd like to say, you know, F you, it's just not that hard. Put it together, right? Just get out there and do it. So of course, the contractors at first thought we were crazy. And then the fascinating thing, because this was a public project, it had to go to the low bidder. Four different firms bid it. And the bids, which typically one might expect a 20 or 30% spread on the bids came in within 2% of each other, because all the risk had been taken out of the project by the drawing set. And so suddenly, nothing got value engineered, everything went through, and a great contractor put it together. And so we did the drawings to show how all the parts would be made, where the flitch plates would go, where the compression ring. We even made templates that wrapped around the compression ring with the instructions for how to weld all the pieces on them. We had all the formwork for the foundation CNC milled. So the contractors just had to shoot four points on the site, and then they fully scaled out templates, and it was drilled into a dig here, and the guys dug. When they laid down the plates on the sill plates, it actually had the instructions for what kind of weld and where it went for how long, just laser cut right into the metal. And so two guys put the building together in 6 weeks without any specialized equipment. And now, I would never say that this would be the way one would build a $500 million project, but it really taught us something, that what you could do is make 95% of your building very, very standard construction. And if you really intelligently use these kinds of strategies for like the key elements, you get to keep your key elements instead of letting them get value engineered in the process. You get to keep the integrity of the building, and your client gets to get a building that looks like they spent a fortune on it, but in fact they really didn't have to, and you get a lot for the money, which in the world of New York architecture is the only way to get something built. So again, here you see the whole site when it was done. There's the camera out at the end. And again, the fascinating thing was the town sort of has had a complete revitalization as a result of this park, where it went from getting 1,000 rides a month on the carousel to up to 50,000 rides per month at $2 a ride. That paid for people to clean the streets, plant flowers, fix up the whole town. Real estate values have gone up and have actually held even after the crash. And again, it was a way to very specifically point to design as a way to kind of connect into the not only the political but also the financial implications in the sort of rebirth of a village. So as we realized we were starting to make money for our clients, we figured, is there a way for architects to try and engage in that portion of the, or that side of the equation as well? So the first time we did that is at a building that we call the Porter House in the meatpacking district of New York City. And so there was a six-story, turn-of-the-century, 1905 warehouse. There were 10 developers chasing after that property. The maximum FAR in this district was 6. So the building was built full, although it had a few buildings to the south that were a little bit shorter. So several of the developers had the idea, can you buy the air rights from the neighboring buildings and transfer them up on top? There was a height limit, and there was a setback requirement. So, you know, if you wanted to get any more air rights and therefore have a few more feet to sell and therefore have a little bit more revenue so you could bid a little bit more on the original building, you had to figure out a way to expand the size of your building. So a few people had the idea of cantilevering over the buildings to the south. And, you know, but of course you have a kind of law of diminishing return, because as the cantilever goes out further and further, it gets more expensive, and then suddenly you actually don't have as much additional revenue in order to outbid your competitors. So we worked again with Craig Schwitter and Bureau Happold in the New York office, who came up with a very clever way of reinforcing an unreinforced masonry building, putting a new, reinforcing an unreinforced six-story masonry building, putting a new six-story concrete and steel building, and getting a sort of two-floor couple and new mini piles that went 90 feet down to bedrock, and to very cost-effectively get our cantilever out just a few more feet, that left us as the only developer able to bid a little bit more to win it. So we didn't have the money, quite frankly, to pull it off ourselves. We approached one of our clients who we really liked and trusted and said, do you want to form a joint venture and let's do this together? And we'll contribute. We had done all this. We had negotiated the air rights. We had the contract in place. We joint ventured with Jeffrey Brown and we started to design it. And so we said, look, we have these two volumes, a historic building and a new building, and let's just think about the material that we want to use, and let's start to think about these fabrication techniques that we've started to develop, and let's use it again as an experimentation, mostly on facade. I mean, the kind of interior thing is really about the strategic, the financial, and the strategic way of making the cantilever and the massing. But as far as the kind of experimentation, it really was on the facade itself. So we said, we wanted to do a metal building. We had never done a building with metal. We decided we wanted zinc, just because we didn't want anything with a kind of applied finish. We wanted a natural material. We went to the zinc facade manufacturers, and they said, sure, we'll do a zinc facade. It costs 40% more than a regular facade. So we said, well, why would it cost 40% more? Just because it does. And I'm like, well, zinc only costs about 15% more than steel, and the raw material is less than half of the whole budget. It should only cost 7.5% more. And they said, well, we don't really care. If you want a zinc facade, it's 40% more. So at that point, of course, in most if you're not grabbing these territories, you get pushed into another material. So we did some research. We found out that most zinc comes from France. And we got on a plane, and we went to France, and we bought 1,000 sheets of zinc that was 1 meter by 3 meter wide. We brought them back to the United States, and we designed a panel system where either one panel, two panels, or three panels unfolded fit on one sheet of raw material. We had 4 window sizes, and we had 2 lighting element sizes, sort of small and large. When you put them all together, it was 21 or 22 basic protoforms. When you took into account different heights and parapets and everything else, it was about 438 unique shapes for 4,000 different shape pieces of zinc in total. So now, of course, this would be really difficult to do, to draw all the shop drawings for that. So it was the first time that we had ever used software to help us do this. It was SolidWorks, where you only had to draw the one panel once and then load all the difference in via spreadsheet for all the different parts. And basically, it went directly from the spreadsheet to the laser cutter that cut all the metal. And so the metal was cut. It had a code system put into the facade that gave you an instruction set for how to put the building together. That instruction set is still there on the facade of the building. So it acts as part of the architectural detailing itself. And we started on one corner of the building and went all the way around. And when we got back to the beginning, we were 1/32nd of an inch off without any shop drawings whatsoever. And we said, OK, this is probably a good idea. And at the same time, a really crappy brick wall with like punched windows and a bad air conditioner underneath, what we call in New York a PTAC, like the worst crap architecture you could ever think of, cost about $50 a square foot for the facade. A nice facade, like they wanted to charge us about $85 for the zinc facade. A decent curtain wall, like on a Richard Meyer building or a Norman Foster building, was about $100 or $125 a foot for the facade. We delivered this facade for $43 a square foot, including everything. And so it was an amazing thing to sort of get this kind of aesthetic, but control the costs and then get it built using the technology. So the typical apartments with a central core, most of them have three exposures. There's two apartments per floor. And one of the things that we really loved about it was this kind of play of depth and shadow by pushing all the windows 14 inches back from the facade. So we really, really wanted that. But then we also thought, gosh, if you push the windows back, you're going to create ledges. And if you have ledges, we have a pigeon issue in New York. And you're going to have a problem with the birds. So we called the Museum of Natural History and asked them, was there an angle of repose that a pigeon would not land on? And they said, yes, it's 34 degrees. Who knew? And so in the drawings, there's a 34-degree angle in front of every single window. And I've actually been in the building and seen a pigeon land, and they go right off the side. And so almost 10 years later, or eight or 9 years later, I'm proud to say there's not one turd on the entire facade of the porterhouse. So you can see the building as it got done. We produced all the collateral materials to bring it to market. We did the interiors. And then the building sort of goes from day to night and becomes this kind of a beacon in the neighborhood. So again, the fascinating thing for us was, you know, when we did this, I will have to say that a lot of our colleagues and the people that we were teaching with were very wary. I mean, they were saying, you know, Gregg, Bill, Kim, Corey, Chris, like, you guys are nuts. You're getting in bed with the devil. This is the slippery slope to hell. You're going to become a developer. All your street cred as a designer is going to get flushed down the toilet. These are all quotes. And I have to say, we were getting nervous. We were like, you know, we were a little scared about it. And it was actually Bernard Tschumi who we went to and asked. And we said, like, do you really think this is going to screw us up? And he's like, oh, no. It's total bullshit. He's like, believe me, Los was a developer. And he went through this whole list of all these architects who had done development on the side to fund their theoretical practice. And he said, go for it. You should definitely go for it. So it was an amazing experience. And the thing that happened, and this is what I really say to you guys as young architects, is what actually happened was the exact opposite of what everyone said. The second we were, as they kind of crudely say, had our skin in the game, it was the opposite. We had total design freedom. Because the developer saw us as a partner, and they saw whatever design ideas we were putting forward, they saw as having like goals to getting to the end product. And it no longer became this acrimonious relationship where it's, this guy's just trying to spend money to get on the cover of a magazine. It was, this guy's trying to show me where to spend and where not to spend as a partner to get the best possible product. And that was the sort of aha moment, I think, in our career. Now, do we want to be design developers, design builders? Is this how every project shop wants to design should be? Absolutely not. That wasn't it at all. Would it be nice to have sort of one of them out of our 10 projects going at a time? I think that would be fantastic. Have we made money doing this? Sometimes we've made money. Sometimes we've gotten crushed. And at the end of the day, let's just make an argument that we broke even. And it's probably pretty close. But it didn't matter. It was such an amazing experience for us to take that risk and learn about what our clients and our competitors and the way in which people have to think about all the things that go into making a building. So all of that effort, all of those experiments, all those things that we learned actually really helped us to be better architects when we're just architects for people. Because we understand what it's like to sit on the other sides of the table. So this is sort of what the building looks like now. I'll show one more developer building just because it was about a kind of fabrication technique. And then we'll move on to sort of the current work in the office for the last sort of year. So this was another one where a client came to us. This time the client found the site. This is the Puck building. This is sort of the last corner in Soho and the first corner in Little Italy on Houston Street in Lower Manhattan. And they asked us if we would joint venture with them on a project. Now, because it was in the Little Italy Historic District, there's a requirement that the building be made of masonry. So we'd never thought ever about building in brick. And we never really thought about masonry, but we said, all right, we'll give it a shot. So what we started to think of is, well, what could you do with bricks in the way that you position them in space, three-dimensionally? And we started to think about this idea of using the computer to make custom formwork, dropping the bricks in, pouring the concrete behind, and lifting it out so that you could have custom shapes on your facade. So we, again, wrote our own scripts to think about and worked with some manufacturers about maximum overhangs and movement of position of brick in order to keep it still waterproof. And we wrote this program that analyzed more than 160 different brick patterns and shapes of the panels within a week. And we were able to kind of determine a system to kind of use this sort of vertical punched window, which is sort of the vernacular in the area, to make sort of the most number of standard panels, least number of eccentric panels, to produce this building. And it was kind of a really interesting project because during the design, it was all about the brick panel, and it was just this kind of feedback loop of how you can make it, the number of pours, the numbers of picks from the crane, the number of panels that got put on, and all of those things helped drive the design. So the last thing where I would say we kind of geeked out the most, but I maybe is my favorite thing about the building is, there's a rule in New York City that you can put up to 15% of your facade over the property line. And so it's meant to have cornices and details on your building. But we were actually able to go into the building department and show them to the brick how far we were going out over that property line. And being able to do that allowed us to push the perimeter of the building 6 inches out more than it normally would have been allowed. And if you take 6 inches times the perimeter of every floor, times the $1,400 a square foot that an apartment like this sells for, that was exactly the same cost as making all the custom formwork for the brick. So in fact, it cost exactly the same as having a totally flat brick building. So here were the test formworks, the bricks. These were some of the early models, the first panel, kind of just how it came down and met the sidewalk, the panels going up. And then this facade that basically was free. And, you know, the building has its pluses and minuses. You know, I think that there's certain things about it that have been a struggle. The bank that was funding us on this project actually went bankrupt in the crash of 2008, 2009. And the building still sits 85% complete and sealed in, but still entangled in a messy lawsuit. So this one has, I don't really show it very often, but I put it up because of the topic and the theme of the lecture series. But it was a really interesting process for us to again, push what you could do, think about materials, think about fabrication, and use that as a way to kind of drive design on a building. So at the end of the day, it's taken us 15 years. We've gone all the way to where we've actually funded ourselves on some of our projects. Every different project type takes a different kind of series of relationships. And we're never going to get rid of this. But if you could just sort of push and pull and tug a little bit at each time, you can begin to change that political playing field to open up more opportunities as a designer to continue to push what is possible. In no way do we feel that this is where we want to end up, like this is like, you know, like from zero to 100. But it's about being fluid in all those different models. So it's helped us with lots of our other projects, like our project we did outside of Seoul, Korea, which is a kind of book house and museum space, our work at for Virgin Atlantic, our building for FIT, which looks finally, after being started and stopped six times over 6 years, looks like it's actually moving forward. It's an academic building for the Fashion Institute of Technology, to clients that we're not allowed to say who they are, especially with a camera rolling. But anyway, doing sort of almost a concert hall, if you will, for a particular private client. But then we sort of, that's kind of like a summary of the first 10 years, and then the last couple of years have changed, and it's been interesting. So we've tried these different things, we've succeeded, we've failed on a lot of them, and you know, but it didn't matter. We felt like we were getting experience and exposure in so many different angles. But one thing that was really interesting was when we hit 50 people, it was really funny. Like we were 45, and you would talk to someone, and they'd be like, "Gregg, I've got an airport. Like, you guys want to do it?" And we'd be like, "Sure, we'd love to do an airport. How big are you?" 45. "Well, call me in a few years." "Gregg, I've got a stadium. How big are you?" "We're 53." "Oh, no problem. You can handle that." 50 became this magic number that was totally irrelevant, but somehow meant that you could do bigger projects. And before the crash, we were up to about 80. After the crash, we had shrunk to about 60. Right now, I think we're about 90 or 95. And it's funny, because there are certain things that change in your practice when you get that big, and some of them are good and some of them aren't so good. But it was interesting. You had to be above 50 if you wanted to do big work. I have no idea why. But we want to do big work, so we're going to stay above 50, no matter how hard we have to struggle to do that. And so the last few projects I'll show are just some of that work and how we went from being a small practice to one that could operate on that scale. So the first one was a competition we won to design an esplanade sort of waterfront on the East River. It's about 2 miles long, happening around the same time that Governor's Island and the Brooklyn Bridge Park were being done. And if you look here, that's the size of Central Park. So we said to the Bloomberg administration, look, you got to think about this as sort of three parks surrounding a harbor, not three separate elements. But very quickly, this was our site. It had an elevated highway. It had all this infrastructure. It had these beautiful 18th century squares that were being used as parking lots. It even had places where you had tons of people and almost no parks here. The water's on the other side of that warehouse. We counted up to 14 layers of chain link fence between where people lived and open waterfront space. So very simply, we kind of looked at streets that worked, streets that didn't work, and we looked at the whole idea of the kind of cross-grain connection. And we said that it was really interesting. What it really came down to as the biggest problem with this park was not, I mean, the warehouses on the fences, the overhead highway, these were all problems, these kind of back streets. But it really came down to one element, and it was the distance between this curb and this curb and what was allowed on that street. And by that street being so wide, not signalized, and filled with like salt piles and trucks, people were afraid to run across and get onto that waterfront. So we said to the city, it's very simple. Get rid of the parking, add trees wherever you possibly can, complete the bike loop around the perimeter of Manhattan. And instead of complaining about having this elevated highway, which, by the way, we tried to get taken down, but for a lot of reasons we weren't able to do. But instead of complaining about that, well, it's actually very interesting. The reason is that the guys who live on the Upper East Side and have their investment banks on Wall, because the highway is totally overbuilt. You need it as far as the Brooklyn Bridge, but the last mile is totally overbuilt. The guys who have their investment banks down on Wall Street like the fact that it's overbuilt, because their black car limousines can get them down there really fast. And they told the city, if you take down the highway, we're moving the banks out of Lower Manhattan, we're putting them in Midtown, and Lower Manhattan will crumble. They had to listen. So go occupy something for this to protest it. So bummer about today anyway. So what we said to them was, look, use it as a free roof. Begin to build a series of pavilions where you can bring culture and the arts and performance and the kind of heart of what makes downtown great out to the waterfront. Plant the trees, finish the bike lane, shrink South Street to a typical New York City 60-foot wide side street. And then whenever you can, use the piers and make double-decker piers with the upper levels passive recreation and the lower levels sort of maritime recreation spaces. So there was a second that was the master plan. There was a second competition that we won in order to actually design the Esplanade. We were working with Ken Smith, landscape architects, and Arup on this project. And so here you could see kind of these were the renderings. So the pavilions that go underneath, we convinced the city to paint the FDR lavender. That took 2 years. And all the lighting is up inside and hits the lavender beam and sort of casts this really beautiful glow. And then this first idea of the kind of double-decker recreation piers. And Pier 35, and these were all the drawings. And now here it is, it's just being finished. The first sections opened this summer, and Pier 15 is opening on the 21st of November. But we had to build up the walls, so we used these black precast concrete walls to build up the soil, because this is actually on a platform over the river to give enough soil depth for trees to grow. Maybe my favorite part of the entire park, I don't know if those of you who've ever noticed, but when you go to a waterfront and you sit on a regulation chair and a 42-inch rail sits right where your eye line meets the water, meets the horizon, and it's a total bummer. So for 4 years, we fought with the city of New York to make all bar seats on the water. So they're high, the railing goes up to 18 inches deep, and you sit high, and you can have lunch, you can plug in your computer, and you can look out over the water. It's all ductile concrete bases, cantilevered bases on the furniture. Here you can see the glowing lavender girder on the FDR Drive. It's incredibly romantic. If you come down here with someone you like, you're guaranteed to fall in love. And then the original drawings of the double-decker pier, it's sort of this big red wing that's held up by these glass boxes. It has a kind of amphitheater section built in where the ramps and stairs come up that look at the historic ships to the north. And this is taken about a week ago. So all the glass boxes have these green roofs, which have become these lawns that you can picnic on. The big undulating red belly. Again, we're still in construction here. But again, all built using the same fabrication techniques. The plannings just went in. Here you can see the historic ships in the amphitheater section. And then how it starts to glow at night. And these are just us taking some pictures. And you can see the Esplanade with the railing here. So a really interesting project. Again, 8 years of working with the city, 126 meetings with the community. You know, a fascinating process to deal with the politics of the 7 different neighborhoods it goes up against. But only through that kind of ability to communicate and have that perseverance did we get it built. And I don't know if I'll do another park again. The interesting thing that came out of it, though, is here's the park and the pier under construction, the first section. It'll eventually, as it goes, as I said, almost 2 miles. But in the middle of that, there's an old development by the Rouse Corporation, which is this really pretty horrific interior three-story shopping mall on the river in front of the Brooklyn Bridge. SHoP's office is right there. And Occupy Wall Street was right there. So anyway, the private developer came to us and said, we love what you're doing on the Esplanade. What would you do if we gave you this pier to redevelop it? We think we have 1 million square feet of buildable air rights. How would you rethink this thing? So we said, well, the reason that New Yorkers don't go there is because it's the place in New York that most reminds them of Boston. And we hate Boston. So we and in fact, it was designed by a Boston architect. And it doesn't work. And so we said, the reason is that it's a controlled environment. It doesn't have the kind of neighborhood, the kind of streets, the kind of alleys you could walk down. In fact, we talked a lot about what are the great little sort of, what are the alleys with the shops on, the arcades in London. We talked about South Bank quite a bit. There's a lot of London that we were trying to sort of get going in here, the things that we like about the way your city hits the waterfront. So again, it was extending and building this pavilions under the FDR, this kind of series of smaller buildings, moving the historic market out to the front, restoring it as a food market, and then putting a 4-acre open space 500 feet out on the water looking at the Brooklyn Bridge. So we worked with James Corner of Field Ops on this project. Again, a lot of the performance-based relationships of street size, proportion, and then we argued that if you could get that 4-acre open space by putting most of the FAR into a tower, this is in a historic district that has 125-foot height limit. Oh, you don't know what FAR is. I'm sorry. FAR is how much you can build on a site. So what do you use here, James? Net to gross. So it's like a, so if I said a, rights, yeah, we don't have rights to light necessarily, because I know. Yeah, but they don't use floor area ratio here, but that's what stands for, floor area ratio. So anyway, we said, let's take all the buildable area and stick it in one tall tower. So instead of building everything as a like 8 to 10 story block that would block the historic neighborhood, let's open up as much space as we can on the waterfront and stick it all into one slender building. Let's use a strategy to dematerialize and break down the scale of that building. Now, granted, it's 125-foot height limit in this area. We proposed a 495-foot tower. That went over really well. But again, this idea of these kind of streets that connect to the bridge, these different layers between a retail and hotels and residential for this mixed-use area. The view from the FDR Drive with the hotels, and then this kind of exoskeleton that held the different programs in these kind of minimalist glass boxes inside the tower, what the proposal looked like. So we got about 3/4 of the way through the approvals process on this, and when the crash hit, our client was General Growth Properties, whose stock went from a total cap of their company's value of $66 billion to zero in 4 months. The largest real estate bankruptcy in the history of the United States. So the interesting thing was that the company was making money. There was no problem with it. It was just that they had made all of their debt to acquire all these properties have 5-year term limits. And $13 billion in debt came due in 2008 and 2009 when no one would refinance it. So here's a company totally solvent, totally making money. The whole project disappears. Fortunately, we stuck with them. Here's the landscape that James Corner designed. I mean, like, this is just, to imagine to be out looking at the Brooklyn Bridge from that far out could just be amazing with these buildings and what it would look like on the skyline. So there's Frank's building before it got value engineered. But the fascinating thing was that the company emerged from bankruptcy. They split into two companies. All the existing properties, the malls, went to General Growth, and then all the development projects went to a new company called the Howard Hughes Corporation because they owned the Howard Hughes lands outside of Las Vegas. And just so you know, this project is fully 100% going again. It will be a different form. In fact, I land on Wednesday night, and Thursday morning is the presentation of the city of what it will look like. So it's happening again, and it's a fascinating project to think about how to build on the water, integrate public space, get a large mixed-use project, and bring it to fruition. So what we hope, the tower we hope remains. So a couple last projects. I think we're doing okay on time. So we did one project in London. I can't talk about who the client was or what we were working on, but it was a fascinating project. Spent a lot of time here. We really want to build here. We love the city, and it was great. We love it just to be here, seeing friends and everything else, but to start to think about building in London was a great challenge. And so the project was for a New York company and a sort of spec office development. So it was a headquarters and a spec building. And we started to think about, you know, sort of the grid versus the London medieval plan, what we called the vertical city versus the horizontal city. This is actually to scale, which really surprised me. I really thought the Gherkin was much bigger before I saw that drawing. That's not anything disparaging against the Gherkin. I was just shocked. And you know, sort of the way we talked about it was, you know, how do you make the client asked for an iconic building. So, you know, do you use a tower? Do you use a square? Do you use a courtyard in order to make the iconic building in the horizontal city? And so we just were sort of, again, this was a very fast competition where we thought about turning, what we love about London is the sort of, you know, you're in the tight streets, they're bending and moving, and then you kind of open into the squares, and then you're back in the tight streets. So we said, what if we took that idea, turned it vertically, and then sort of made these kind of connections between the ground and the open spaces above and the volume of the building. Looking down towards St. Paul's, there was a lot of issues with view corridors that needed to be maintained and right to light and other issues that we were dealing with here in London. Kind of keeping the extension of the old street plan moving through the site. Two buildings, one being a headquarters, one being a spec office building. What were the relationships between those buildings? How would we think about the two of them? I think we sort of ended up at cousins. And again, this idea of taking the London Square, putting it in the air, pushing it out so it started to connect to the landmarks that it could see from this open park in the sky, and then allowing those, so you'd always have these kind of views from those positions, and then almost thinking about how the piece of sculpture on the top of the building would be read from the landmarks where it could be seen. And so the proposed idea of the building here with this kind of open glass and these sort of vertical circulation zones going through. And that these would always connect directly down to the street and the icons around the site. And what would that be like, where you could see the sort of Tate Modern, St. Paul's, and the street itself with all of the circulation and meeting rooms and the kind of big open square above. The kind of idea of what that drawing is. That drawing scares the crap out of me. It just recently started to remind me of Daniel Libeskind, and I'm going to get rid of it really fast. So again, looking down these Escher-like volumes, the kind of typical floor plates, and sort of the view looking back from Queen Victoria Street, I believe, looking to the east. And what it would look like. So we came in second on this one, which was a bit of a bummer, because we really wanted to be here. We wanted to open an office in London. We were fully committed to coming, and hopefully we'll be here very, very soon. We lost to Norman Foster, so okay, home turf, we got it. You know, no problem. But then we went up against him again in another building in Africa. So this is in Botswana. But it was an interesting project because, again, it was another competition. This is a project that we had been working on for Google. The founders of Google had asked us to do a research project for them to do their first ground-up building that they've done in the company's history out in Mountain View, California. And the program was 400,000 feet of engineering and research space, and it needed to be three levels past LEED Platinum, our highest sustainable rating. So we said that's, in fact, they wanted a net zero building, and even though every single person has two 42-inch vertical screens on every single desk to write code. So we said, well, that would be really hard and take a long time and a lot of research, and they said, okay. So we worked on it for 3 years. I mean, we studied everything from bicycle riding, slides for stairs, ramps, every technology you could think of. Even we studied dirigible commuting with landing pods on the roofs of the building. This is where we came out. But the kind of main idea was this sort of energy blanket idea, sort of stacking the parking underneath. You, for a lot of reasons, you can't go underground, berming the land up, and then all these systems of getting air and light to circulate through the building. Now, with that said, we entered this competition for what was called the Innovation Hub in Botswana, Africa, which was basically a high-tech office park. And we took this research and then just kind of repositioned it in a South African climate. And taking some of the ideas for the landscape in Botswana, there are two sort of well-known landscape elements, are sort of the dunes and the deltas. And this notion of kind of slicing up those two elements in order to make a kind of series of buildings with connecting pieces that became this environmental incubator for Botswana, converting its diamond wealth into a high-tech industry. So taking, again, the same performative relationships, the same scripts that helped generate the Google building, it produced this. And so this was the competition entry. We were told it came down to us and Norman a second time, and fortunately this time we got him, and we won. So again, there were these amazing 200-year-old trees that we left in place. We put the parking on grade, bermed up around each side, and allowed the trees to come up through the courtyards. So you can see, which made these shading elements, these seating elements, there's water retention, the same roof, these kind of glass bridges that connect you between the different elements of the building. Again, a lot of the sustainable performance modeling that we did, taking that in connection with local building traditions and trying to blend those two into a kind of system of assembly that could both be complex but also easily able to be assembled on site. And right now, this is sort of the current drawings. Actually, this is the end of DD. We're about 50% through construction documents now. And the building is under construction. All the site work is just about finished, and we'll start hopefully in about 4 or 5 months with the overall building. But it's been a fascinating process to not only go to Botswana, but also to train everyone in Revit, to start to talk to the local contractors, to start to get them involved in investing in CNC technology. Everyone is on board, everyone knows it's the future, and in some ways they're actually more open than New York contractors are. Maybe they have less to hide. And it's pretty fascinating. So it's definitely an exciting thing to be able to say that, well, this can be built anywhere. These kinds of technologies and CNC issues, fabrication and performance-based design, doesn't only have to happen in global capitals. And so the very last project I'll show is the Barclay Center Arena. For those of you who may know a little bit of the history, this was a Forest City Ratner development over an old train yard in downtown Brooklyn. So it's a highly controversial project that involves eminent domain issues, the taking of private land by the government, which is something that's happened, of course, all through our country's history, but typically it's for public projects. Very recently it started to happen for private projects, and it's caused a lot of issues, some of which I agree with, some of which I don't agree with. The developer originally picked Frank Gehry to be the architect. He did a brilliant master plan and a brilliant idea. The centerpiece of the project is a new arena that will be the home to the New Jersey Nets, who are an NBA team that are going to move to Brooklyn and become the Brooklyn Nets. So Brooklyn will have its first sports team since the Dodgers left for Los Angeles 50 or 60 years ago. And it became sort of the political linchpin of getting this project approved. Mr. Gehry's design was a brilliant scheme that had four huge towers with very large foundations that held the bowl of the arena inside the base of the buildings. So that, in fact, 80% of the arena was not visible from the street. It was embedded in the buildings itself. This is a great design, except for 2008, 2009, when those four buildings are unfinanceable and unbuildable. And so the tax laws in New York, in the United States were going to change. And if the building was not in the ground by December 31st, 2009, there would be hundreds of millions of dollars in lost tax revenue by the developer. So they had to redesign the building quickly. They went to a design-build contractor who said the only way you can do it is if you pick a building that's already been designed by an architect who's done lots of NBA arenas. They did that. The city wasn't very happy. And then David Childs, the head of, they, so the developer was stuck, and David Childs, the head of SOM, suggested that they talk to us. They came to us and they said, can you redesign this entire arena? And we said, how long do we have? And they said, you have 7 weeks to design it, detail it, price it. This should take at least a year. And we said, no problem. It's a really bad summer. And this was basically what we did. So let's just call this the box that we were given, which had a kind of a traditional brick arch aesthetic. We said that that a kind of vertical massing was the wrong way to go, and that we felt it needed to be broken into these horizontal bands. One that kind of related to the five-story buildings around, one that was sort of transparent that related to the upper concourse of the stadium, and then this kind of halo that sculpturally floated on the skyline. So we said it was very important that the building didn't feel dead during the times that the games were not going on. So it was all about loading as much retail as we possibly could on the street and as many clear views in directly into the bowl itself, including being on the entry plaza and being able to see right in, which I'll show you in a second. And then there's this large entry plaza. So there was this notion of Bernini meets Brooklyn, kind of coming out like this, and making these sort of large cantilever with a big oculus under it to make the sort of front door of the arena. So there are 9 subway lines underneath this site, plus a Long Island Railroad station, so one of the most complicated sites in the city. And so this idea that most people will come by train, come up to the plaza, and again, this idea of a kind of wrapping skin that goes around all the elements and an idea of what the arena might look like. So again, here's the front door, the kind of lower part. This is an 80-foot cantilever, 35 feet in the air. And that directly when you come out of the subway, you can see right through the glass, right through the bowl to the scoreboard from the public space. So there's this immediate kind of draw in. And what the arena will look like. So it's 12,000 pieces of plate steel, no two are alike, all custom fabricated directly from SHoP and SHoP Construction's files. They have a weathered steel, sort of like a core 10, if you will, that are then assembled into mega panels in a factory in Indianapolis, shipped to New York, and clipped onto the building. So again, we then designed all the public spaces, the interiors, the clubs, the exit for the train station here, and you come up, and then we were able to convince the client to put all the digital boards on the inner ring of the oculus so that it didn't blare out into the local neighborhood and made this incredible kind of moment as you look up through and at the sky, as demonstrated there. So there you can see the scoreboard and the kind of main entry. Now there are going to be up to 16 buildings built on this site, but the first 3 actually hug around the arena. Here's the open plaza space. And then we propose that when the games aren't on, they do sort of like live video feeds from Prospect Park, or they could show movies, or you could show anything on these boards. We took the steel and wrapped it inside into the spaces so that the sort of rails became these light boxes with this kind of darkened night sky above. So the shape comes right through, super minimalist for all of the elements, almost like Donald Judd boxes of weathering steel for all the concession stands. The bowl, we're really pushing to get it as dark as possible, so it's more like a kind of black box theater. Jay-Z is one of the owners of the Nets, so we get to work very closely with him on the design of all of the club spaces, which is fantastic. He's an amazing client, along with Bruce Ratner, who really cares about art and wants to make this not feel like your typical arena in any way, shape, or form. These are some of the club spaces. I still don't know what that guy is doing over there. but then again, we're a bunch of, we're in our early 40s. We've never built a building this big. We've never done something this complicated. How did we get them to give us the project? And it was because we went to them and said, here is how you build it. We didn't say, here's an object and a design, and now you go figure it out. We said, here's how you could build something, and by the way, this is how it looks, and we think it's beautiful. And so the whole presentation was this, with the unfolding of the 12,000 panels. We did all the CATIA modeling ourselves. Every single panel is unfolded into a ticket. This is all done in a joint venture now with SHoP and the facade contractors. And here are the panels. So these are, this is 4 mega panels. So the enclosure actually sits behind, and there's a scaffolding that holds this patterning out outside, and then it's lit from inside at night. Every panel is tessellated with a 1-foot fold that goes into the darkness, so you get a sort of shadow in the day and a reversal at night. The panels are all cut, hung on this track. It's like a dry cleaning rack, and it takes 4 months for the panel to go through the factory. It goes through 15 wet-dry cycles a day for 4 months, and when it comes out, it has 10 years of patina on it. And the panels, here they are drying. And then every single panel, we developed this barcode system. Every single one is tagged, and we wrote our own iPhone app. So any single person from Bruce Ratner to the guy who's bolting it in can go to any panel at any time, use his iPhone, scan it. A 3D model of the project comes up. They know where it is in the production sequence, where it is in the weathering sequence, which mega panel it's on, where that truck is located between Indianapolis and New York, where it is on the site, and where it gets attached to the building. So here are the panels going on the trucks. These were the first test ones. Here's the building under construction. This is about 6 months ago. Here are the panels going up right now. And you can see it's a sort of highly reflective glass so that you get this amazing, like this blue sky or the gray sky sort of pops through in the day, and then this kind of snakeskin meets Sarah kind of wrapping element. Here are the pieces as they're going up. This is taken about 3 or 4 weeks ago. The kind of spline, this is up on the upper deck. Here they are going in, hard at work. And this has never been shown before, but I will show it. On Thursday, we have an all-day press conference that SHoP will be announced as the designer and builder of the first 3 towers, 1.7 million square feet of housing. That is mostly affordable housing. There is a housing crisis in New York, and what will be announced on Thursday is that the tallest modularly constructed building in the world is here in the UK. It's 21 stories. I believe it was built in 1968. The client has funded us, working with the unions, with the different contractors. But we are going to build a factory in Brooklyn and build the 3 tallest modularly constructed buildings in the world in order to make it affordable. So this has never been shown. It will be shown. It'll be in the New York Times on Friday. Please don't put this online until after that. Appreciate it. Sure. You can just don't put it online until next week, and then we're good. But again, a really, really tight budget, a really difficult construction site, a client that really cared about and thinking about how to remake the construction industry. But this will be a 54-story modularly constructed building. Everything will arrive completely done on site, down to the paint, the switch plates, the toilets, everything installed in steel boxes stacked 54 stories tall. We are in a joint venture with Forest City to build this, and believe that it's actually the hope to making affordable housing in the city of New York. So again, but still thinking about street life, about color, about materials, the way it integrates with the arena itself, and the way that they start to, these are the first 3 buildings, there'll be 12 more going along the yards out this way for a total of 6 million square feet. And then, this is before how people know the buildings right now, but then again at night, what the arena will look like as the interior lights hit those folded plates. So in conclusion, we're not calling for a new period or a new style or a new way of working necessarily, but I think that we are calling for a generation of architects to reject what has been done before, which is to only think of design as the image. We believe that it's an amazing time to be a young architect. We believe that the technological changes are making this kind of incredible shift where there's opportunities to kind of grab back territories that have been systematically taken away from us over the previous decades. We believe that the thickness of architecture, getting beyond just what the building looks like, how it works, how it goes together, its materiality, its changes over time, its flexibility, and the ability to kind of get dirty as architects and understand that. Don't be afraid of the technology. Don't be afraid of the political process. Don't be afraid of the financial process. No one's saying you have to joint venture with your clients. We only do that every once in a while. But the point is, learn what they're dealing with, because the more that you grab those extra territories, the more that you engage in that kind of, in those realms of interaction, I truly believe the more chance you have to have a seat at the table and to have an influence over the kinds of buildings that get built. At the end of the day, the most, in our belief, the five of us really believe that the most sustainable thing you can do is build buildings that people love, so that they can forget about, PVs are great, all these technologies are great. Build buildings that people love, that they take care of, that have multiple uses over multiple generations, and that are beautiful and inspire. It's not about technology for technology's sake, it's technology's sake for the sort of making beauty, making art, making people love the buildings, making people love being in dense environments, because dense environments are the only way that we're going to go forward. So the point is, I believe in architecture, I believe in what it contributes to the production of culture, and I believe that the only way to do it is to not just look at the image, but to get very deep and into the thickness and to get involved in these kinds of technologies and methods of building. Thank you very much.
Gregg, thank you so much for an absolutely inspiring and candid talk. I'll open up to the floor a minute for a few questions, but maybe first for me, one observation is it was fascinating to see the early work again, because it's been a while, let's say, but it's also, you kind of documented this very interesting move between a kind of young practice working directly on projects, in the sense that you're in total control of the design to production. And in a way, that can become kind of limiting, in that you can only do a project of a certain scale or of a certain kind of limited complexity. And I think what I'm interested, what was really fascinating, was to see when you had to move up a scale or a level of complexity. For example, the two apartment building you showed, the only way you could do it was by actually being the client yourself, sense. And I'm just very interested in, and I think maybe for the people here as young designers, you come up against all kinds of constraints, be it the AAI, or in, I think even more so in this country with REBA, who I don't actually think are as far advanced in their sense of the future of architectural procurement. But I'm interested in what you think, or how you, maybe learning a little bit more about how you dealt with that, how you dealt with that shift to a slightly larger scale and larger level of complexity?
Quite frankly, I don't, to be really honest, I don't know. We just battled at every stage and just tried to, I mean, look, the whole joke about being an architect is you're unfairly underqualified to do something if you haven't done one of a type, and then you're unfairly overqualified to do it if you've gotten one built. Do you understand that? That is the whole crux. David, you know what this is like. This is our lives. It's the whole crux. Like, oh, the porterhouse is quite successful. You did a 10-story condominium. Do you think you could handle a 12-story rental building? Yeah, it's two more drawings in the set. Like, I don't know. I don't know if you could do that, right? Like, it's crazy. Like, the clients are crazy. Like, so you're just battling at every single step to kind of get to the next stage and to figure out, how do you bring fresh thinking? How do you say that the way that it's always been done isn't necessarily the best way? And try and show the kind of value that you can provide, both sort of financially, politically, but also aesthetically. It's that triangle offense you're constantly trying to give. But it's the battle. The battle is, how do you move up in every scale and every type?
And did you find to do that it was really necessary to set up the SHoP construction as the entity, if you like, to handle that?
I don't think we've ever gotten a job because of SHoP construction. I think that maybe we've gotten some things built better than they would have been had we not had that sister company around. But honestly, most of the projects we've gotten have been won in competitions. And so they have no idea that SHoP construction is there. But I think that the process of actually getting the buildings built was aided several times by our sister company.
But you raise another point there, which is kind of, I would have expected to be more the routine, which is that, in a sense, very often clients aren't aware or interested of how it gets done. And it was very noticeable that you mentioned here that one of the ways you got the project was actually laying all this stuff out and saying, well, this is how we would do it. That's quite unusual as well, isn't it?
I don't know. It's just been the only way that we've been able to do it. I mean, I think that there's always a balance. I mean, I think sometimes being so technically proficient maybe has hurt us, because they think, well, maybe these guys are just, you know, like in love with their computers. I've actually had a client say that to me once. You're just in love with your computer. That's all you really care about. It's like, really? That's interesting. So we didn't get the job. So I think that the way we've gone about practice has worked for us. Mm-hmm. I believe that architectural practice has incredible opportunities to be reinvented and to be a much better practice. I think the things that we offer as architects to the production of culture is, I don't want to say undervalued, I think it's very valued, but there's so much more we have to give. And we have such an important role to play in the production of space as cities need to get more and more dense. And so whatever methodology you can use to, if you will, scratch and claw your way to the table, use it. I guess what I'm making a call for is, as a generation coming out of school now, take advantage of anything you can. It's not just one model of entering beautiful images into competitions and hoping you win one. I'm sure you'll all win one at some point, but it's expand what we do. I've said this many times, I truly believe that we are the last great generalist profession. What we're good at, what our skill set is that we're good at a lot of different things and we're good at synthesizing those together, right? But I think that for some reason in the last 30 years, there's been this desire, I don't know what it is, to make us specialists in form and image. And I think that's only one thing that we offer. And so all I say is, just go out and whatever it is, get dirty doing other stuff, and then also make it look really cool. If you can sort of do that, I think you're doing what we do best.
Any other questions from the audience?
I just had one question. In the beginning, you were explaining how your design processes were influenced by your technological processes of manufacturing. And towards the end, you were showing projects which were fairly larger in scale, and the processes were driven by more by architectural strategies. And I just wanted to know if that was a conscious shift, or was it because it's far more challenging to use those kind of manufacturing technologies at such large scales?
I think we've been trying to do both at both scales. I mean, that whole system right there of what you're looking at is all comes out of a manufacturing technique, as well as a kind of site strategy, program strategy. I mean, very typical architectural concern. So, you know, I think that it also has a highly political angle to it as well, which is dealing with what was going on. I mean, this client was sued 34 times to stop this project. He went 34-0. But we were involved in many of those towards the latter end of the project. And so it's, but this design actually helped heal some of the battle scars. So I think that there's just multiple levels that we try and work, and I don't think there was a shift in strategy. It's we're architects, we're designers, we like beauty, we like elements, and if we use technology to get us there, then that's what we're just trying to do.
Any further questions?
How much do you think your practice has been held back by the inability of the contractors to actually build this stuff? You've described how easy you make it for them to do it. And on the Greenport project, the small building, you had control over it because it was almost domestic. Trying to convince someone to do it on that scale, you know, I'm so pleased to see it's coming off and that it's there. And I kind of get the feeling that once clients can say, oh, right, that's how you build a building, and the contractor goes, oh, I can build that too, and probably do it with minimal waste and everything else that goes on with it. How much do you think now that will unlock for you, you know, project, not just projects in Botswana, but, you know, so much more that I think you can do?
I think that's a really good question. The answer is that right now, they're all, like, the light bulb is going off. Right, and here's an $850 million project, and it's going off, and it's going together, and it's working perfectly. Not to say that there aren't challenges in doing it, but it's people are standing around going like, "Wow, we never thought this could happen, and it's happening." So it's happening, and the big contractors in New York are now going after architects left and right to go on staff to help run all their BIM and their digital fabrication and all that stuff. I mean, so they get it now. I mean, we've been screaming for 10 years, and the last two or three, they're getting it. Now the first buildings are being built, and in 5 or 10 years, this is going to be normal. So whether it unlocks anything specifically for SHoP, I don't know. I mean, all we're hoping is that we get a few built, and people like them, and then they want to come back and have more. I mean, for us, it's about just a generation of really good architects who are getting their shot at building now. You know, the old guys are starting to move away, and it's now the turn of the 40-somethings and the 30-somethings who maybe 30 years ago wouldn't have had a chance. But because of the technological shift, you know, we have a much better chance at performing at these levels. So I think it's an amazing time, as I said, to be a young architect and coming into practice. I'll do one more, and then it's time for a martini.
Hello. It was very interesting to see how you stretched the practice back to the both side, to the developer side and construction. Especially, it's very interesting to see it does generate very competitive and interesting idea, especially in the housing project. You want the bit. And on the other hand, you say you have like around 93 staff. So my question is, how do you organize this different entity in your organization? How do you provide platform through, have conversation through the different organization? Does it only happen in a higher place? Or what's your way to sort of to encourage the discussion?
I would actually say that it's totally bottom up, that it probably happens the least at the top of the practice. That SHoP Construction, which is maybe 30 of the people, let's say all the other companies are 30 and SHoP Architects is 60. It's round numbers, that's about right. They sit in the middle of the architects. They're debating back and forth constantly, and there's no silos. I mean, when we work on other architects' projects, they just work on the projects, and sometimes they say like, hey, what do you think of this? I want to solve the problem for the architect here. But the designers are there, and they just ask them like, I really want a piece of metal to do this, this, and this. What do you think, what's the easiest way for a contractor to put that together? And so there's this constant back and forth. The applications company is sitting there, and the software designers are there, and they're saying, God, if we could just have a tool that would do this, it could save us this, this, and this, and the guys write them a tool. And then we test it out for a while, and now we're starting to say, well, should we just commercialize these things? Just make it something that every architect could use. So it's very organic, it's very interdisciplinary, and I would say that the 5 or /6 partners at the top of the food chain are the least in the know of everyone. And we're proud of that. Anyway, all right, one last one all the way in the back. Just stand up and talk.
And at what age and after how many practices you've worked for do you think you can start to think about starting your own business? Would you consider doing it in a time of recession? Because most of the projects that I've worked on, I found that all the skills and knowledge has actually been self-taught, and each project has been individual in different skill sets. So even though you can carry on experience from one project to the other, each project has had a different set of challenges. And I'm just wondering, at what point should I wait, and at what age, and after how many big practices I've worked for, could I start to think about starting my own practice?
Okay, all right. David, how old were you when you started your practice? 27. I was, what, 32, 30? I don't know. 31. How old are you? How much? You're in your 30s. My feeling is go out and start your practice tomorrow. Seriously, like it doesn't, no one really knows what they're doing, so don't worry about it. You think I'm kidding, I'm not kidding. I mean, I won't name names, but we've joint ventured with other really big famous practices and we sit down and we're like, are you kidding? They don't know what they're doing either. They're like, well, it's ridiculous. So just, I'm not being flippant. I really believe like if you want your own practice, and I'm not saying that everyone has to have their own practice. I mean, it comes with an unbelievable number of headaches, difficulties, joys, despair. It's, you know, it's not for the faint of heart. But if you want your own practice, I'd start it tomorrow. And just get out there and, like we said, like scratch and claw and figure out how to get a client and then figure out how to design it and figure out how to build it and get it done and move on to the next one. But I have a lot of people that come to me and say, I'm an architect, but I really see that so much of the power is in developing, and I want to be a developer, and I'm thinking about going to get my MBA at Columbia or Harvard, and I'm like, don't you want to get, you? It's like, go get your MBA at Harvard or Columbia. You'll get a job working for a developer. It's like, you want to be a developer? Take the $100,000 that you were going to spend at Harvard, go buy a piece of property, fix it up, and sell it. You're a developer. And I feel that same way about architecture. Like, you want to have your own practice? Go out there and do it. And do it as fast as you possibly can. Because it takes at least 5 years to get up and running. And so the sooner you do it, the sooner it'll happen for you. All right, on that positive note,
yes,
I'm going to call it quits.
All have an early
Thank
start
you very,
tomorrow.
Very much.
Thank you for coming.